Bonjour, mes amis. Ça va? Today I want to talk about type systems, about static type systems, and about runtime type systems. And usually when people hear the word type systems, they're like, oh, that's like a lot of additional work, and also it doesn't catch all of the bugs, so why should I use type systems? So before I explain that, let's go a little bit back in history. So 200 years ago, there was this guy who figured at some point that he didn't like the Russian Tsar. So he figured he was going to conquer Russia and defeat his army. And he had everything going for him. I mean, he was the best strategist in the world, maybe in history. And he had the best trained army, the best generals. And best of all, he had also the biggest army. He gathered 700,000 soldiers. And with that army, he went to Russia. So what could go wrong? Well, in essence, not that many things did go wrong. I mean, they fought a bunch of battles, and they won all of them. And actually, in the end, they did conquer Moscow. But still, that whole journey became one big disaster, and over half of that army died in the end. And so what you can learn from that lesson is that, like, detecting errors earlier is better. I mean, if you're going to conquer Brussels and then you figure out it doesn't work, it's okay, then you can flee back to Paris in like a matter of hours. But if you're in Moscow, then it's a really, really long way back. And so where did it go wrong? Well, the problem was, like most things that go wrong, he made the wrong assumptions. So Napoleon figured that it's way too hard to bring enough croissants to Russia for 700,000 soldiers. So he just assumed, like, well, we will find food during the journey. But they didn't, and they had lack of food, and also turned out to be like really cold in Russia. So basically, what you can conclude is that assumptions are the reason why things go wrong in the end. And so that is what static type systems are about. They are basically about validating the assumptions you have. So static type systems, they make all the assumptions you have explicit. They will tell you, like, this function is expected to be called with these kind of arguments. And as a nice benefit from that, they also make your API and your internals very discoverable. And best of all, they provide a super short feedback loop. So you get feedback about your code without even running it, without ever writing a unit test. At least a bunch of stupid errors will be detected for you. And so you get basically a 100% coverage without writing a single test. So is everything then perfect in static type check land? Well, no, it isn't. There are also limitations to static type checking. So for example, what a static type checker assumes, especially when it compiles down in the end to JavaScript, is that an implementation holds up to the contract you specify. So here's a super simple example. We have a function, and in the end, it returns a promise of a food array. And so you call this function, and then you get food, and then that's an array, so you can join it, and you can print it to the console. So everything looks nice. Type checker is completely fine with this. And then you run the code, and then you actually get a runtime exception. Why do you get this runtime exception? Well, look at the server we're calling. TypeScript, for example, cannot reason about what the FETS API will return in the end. So if the server looks like this, this is not going to deliver an array with food. It's saying just, nope, no food. And sometimes there are these cases where you, just as a programmer, have deeper understanding about the about the code than the static type checker has. So sometimes you just know that something is always true, and then you enter the world of casting. And I know it's kind of ugly sometimes, but sometimes you just need it to express something you know, which the type checker can't infer. And finally, type checkers also assume that consumers keep the contract. And this is something I've run into a lot when developing MobX. It's like I write this beautiful API, I type it very accurately, and so I expect, for example, this function to be called with either a number or a string, and then it does the code, and then it does its thing. And then, at some point, somebody will raise an issue in the issue tracker, and he says, hey, I've got this weird object, and there's a key in it, and it's called object object. And it's like, how did you get there? Please give me a reproduction. And so then in the end, there's a reproduction, and it turns out that they put an object as first argument instead of a string or a number. And I'm like, why? The contract was clear. You are supposed to put a string or a number in there. But then it's like, the guy's like, well, I don't use a type checker, so I made an accident. And, well, we cannot make assumptions about how consumers are calling your APIs when they don't use a type checker. So static type checkers are super useful, but they're also, in the end, limited. So what you then end up doing is that first you write a static type for your function, and then you write, additionally, some assertions to make sure that people that don't use a type checker still hold up to the contract. And then somebody will file an issue that your bundle becomes too large, so then you have to filter it out in production builds. And then in the end, you have a function which has six lines of type checking and one line of actually doing something. And so you might conclude, OK, then let's stop with this static type checking stuff. But no, I don't think that's a good idea. That's like saying, I stop using a spell checker because my secretary will find more errors. But there's more than static type checking. There's also runtime type checking. And runtime type checks have their own advantages. So they are reasoning about the actual values. And also you can like use the full language to express the checks you want to write. And so you might be already actually familiar with runtime type systems without even realizing it. If you're using, for example, prop types or MobX state tree or GraphQL, and there are many more examples of type check systems that run at runtime. So let's build our own runtime type checker, because it's actually pretty easy. So you've seen a similar slide this morning. What are types? Types are basically expressing whether a value belongs to a certain domain of values or not. So we have all values in the world, and a subset of that are all the primitives, and within that we have all the booleans, and booleans are a super simple domain because there are only two values in there, true and false. And with numbers you can do similar stuff. So in essence, a type is a function that, given a value, tells you whether that value belongs to the domain of the type. This is our basic concept of a runtime type. And so the most simple type we could write is a type check function for strings. And we just check whether the value is a type of strings. So let's go to a slightly more interesting example. Let's say that we want to keep some administration of soldiers. We have a big army, after all, to get to Moscow. And every soldier, a proper description, has a name, has an age, and a soldier has a role in his unit. And so we've already seen how to type check his name, how to check if it's a string. So let's see, how can we type check that a soldier has a proper age? And also we want to make sure that it doesn't have false positives. So if we put something in with five gears, that might be a car, we're not sure, but at least it's not a valid soldier. So when you talk about age, you can just say, well, it's a number, but that's not a very precise description. We can make add more conditions. So we can ask, is it an integer? And we can even ask, like, is it a sane integer? I mean, a negative age doesn't make sense. An age of 2000 also doesn't make sense. That's probably not describing a human. So we can actually be more fine-grained than just checking for numbers. So let's do that in our runtime type system. So first, we want to check whether it's a number. That's simple, the same as for the string. And then we can check if it's an integer. Is this a proper number? So first we check, is it a number? And if that's okay, then we do some binary operation. And I don't know how this works, but I find it on Stack Overflow. And it turns out it does actually do the trick. And so if you pass a different bunch of values in here, it will properly tell which of these values is actually a valid integer. So and it means that we can also easily express the age of a soldier. So first we check if it's an integer, and then we check if the value is within a sane range. And so humans don't get usually older than 130, especially not 2 centuries ago. So this should work. But then if you look at it, especially if you look at the last test case, 73 is a valid age, but probably you don't want to have a guy at the age of 73 walking to Moscow. So maybe we should be more precise. So maybe we want to express like, the age is not just any valid human age. We want ages between 18 and 40. That is a way more accurate way to describe it. And so actually, we want to parameterize our types. But luckily, this is JavaScript, and we have functions and such. So this is actually easy, because we can, like, instead of age being a type, we can make it into a function that returns a type, that returns a type check function. So we pass our age function to parameters, and then with that, we return a new type check function that correctly validates these ranges. So that means that we can now make way saner checks. So we can introduce a human age, and we can introduce a soldier age, and then we use the last for our soldiers. And so we were now able to type check our name, and we are able to type check the age. So how do we type check the role of soldier and his unit? And there are super difficult French words to express the role of soldier and a unit. So definitely you want to type check those. I mean, I'm not going to write this correctly without type checker. But before I show you how to do that, let's take one step back. Let's talk about literal types. And literal types are actually a very interesting set of types because they are types that exist of a domain with exactly one value. So for example, we have the null type, which exists of only one value, namely null, and same for undefined. And actually you can generalize that concept of having a type of exactly one value, and that's what we call a literal type. So a literal type is configured, parameterized with one value, the value of the domain, and then it turns us a type check function that just checks, is that value inside our domain? And so we can now write null and undefined a bit simpler. And why is this useful? I'll show you in a second. First, another type, the union type. And if you ever used Flow or TypeScript, you are familiar with unions. It's basically, given a set of types, it just checks if a value is at least belonging to one of those types. It's basically an OR operator. And so we could, for example, write a union of the soldier type and an undefined type. And then we can pass it an undefined value, which is true. Undefined is part of that union. but a car is not part of that union because it's neither undefined and it's not a soldier either. And now we can combine unions and literals, and this is where it gets interesting. So now we can suddenly express the role of our soldier by saying the role of soldier is either one of these literal types. In other words, it's either one of these strings. And in fact, as you might realize, we've just invented enumerations. And so this type won't succeed on a string like wizard, that's more belonging to an RPG, but it does validate on a grenadier. And so we can make that even a bit simpler and introduce the type of enumerations, which is just taking a set of values, and for each of value, it creates a literal type and then takes a union of it. So then can we write it very neatly, just like this. And so with that, we've captured the type of all the primitive fields of our soldier. So now there's only one thing left to do, and it is basically answering, how do we validate that an object fulfills all those constraints? And it's actually pretty easy. So this shape type, and you might also recognize it from prop types, it basically takes a map of properties, which is a name mapped to a type, and then it returns a type check function. It takes the value and checks whether that value for each of the properties in that value matches the type. And so if we run that, this will exactly type check what we wanted to type check. I can actually prove that. So here we have all the code we've written so far in our talk, all the generic types, and then we define the soldier type with eight, a soldier role, and the shape of a soldier. And then our test produce what we expected. So we've now written a type system with just a few lines of code. It's actually a really powerful type system. And you now should have gotten the hang of it, and we can even take it a little step further. So say that you want to type an army, or basically a collection of soldiers. And you can, of course, introduce a type for a collection, a list, for example. But it's a bit of a crappy implementation to use this to type an army, because it would succeed on an array of soldiers, but it also would succeed on an array of cars, which doesn't make sense. So we do need generics, right? This is why everybody who's older than 30 remembers Java 1.5, which didn't have generics, and then you always had this kind of crap. But turns out, because we're using a runtime type system, we don't need generics. What we need is higher order types, or types that take other types as arguments. So what you want to express is that an army is just a list of soldiers. So what does the list type look like? Well, it's pretty simple. It takes a type, and then returns a function that checks whether the value is an array, and that every element in that array matches our type. And done. And so now you probably see how composable these types are. So you can do even weird stuff as like, I have a type for a Grande Armée, and it's basically an array which has at least 1 million horses and soldiers. So runtime types are very interesting, especially because you don't need casting, you don't need generics, but you're just using function composition everywhere. But of course, as everything in the world, also this has its downsides. So for example, your feedback will be late. If the code never runs, it is actually never checked. And if your unit tests don't cover all your code paths or all your possible values, then your coverage is incomplete. So what if I told you that you could have the benefits of both static typing and runtime typing? And that's actually possible. We can have the best of those two worlds. And not just in one way, we can even have it in two completely different ways. So the first way is actually pretty simple. We can basically use our static types and use them at runtime. And a good example of that is Flow Runtime. So what Flow Runtime does, it takes your flow file, which has some type definitions in it. And then then it has a Babel plugin that when you compile your code, it actually generates all the type checks for you. So the generated code in the end looks a bit like this. So it generated all the code needed for our runtime type system, and it will be actually impossible to call this function even from an untyped consumer with a wrong value. But it is still limited to what can be expressed with static types. And static types can express things like numbers, but not things like integers, at least not in JavaScript. So what if I told you that we can also do the opposite? Use our runtime types at design time. And that's really weird if you think about it. That's really the inception that is nowadays possible. And I'll show you in a bit how amazing that is, but first let me explain the principles. So the first question we have to ask if we want to build such a system, what is the type of a type? What is the static type of a runtime type? Yes, it's a difficult question, right? Everybody still awake? So we earlier saw that a type check function is just a function that takes a value and returns a boolean. So the static type of a runtime type is basically a generic, which is a function that takes a value and then returns a boolean describing whether that value belongs to the domain. And what's crucial here is that this is TypeScript, is that we use the is keyword here. And the is keyword signals TypeScript that this function will return a boolean, but this boolean has actually more meaning than just being a boolean. It actually makes TypeScript understand that this value is a valid instance of t. Yeah, this is the stuff part of my talk, sorry. And so we can annotate now our number type checker we had earlier as just being a type that checks whether a value is a number. So we now typed our number type. And I can actually show that it works. So here we have basically the same types. And I have this small print function. And I pass it a parameter x. And x is any, it can be anything. TypeScript doesn't know anything about it. And then we pass it through our number type. And now the interesting thing is that in the true branch of the if statement, TypeScript suddenly knows that x is a number. Even though we write that whole number type function ourselves, TypeScript understands that if number type returns true, then I know for sure that x is a number and not anything anymore. But in the else branch, it doesn't know anything about it, so it will infer any again. So let's take it a little step further. So we can also type unions like this. So a union is in the end a type that takes two other types. It's a higher order type in itself. And then it returns a function that will tell where that value is either a valid A or a valid B. And so we can take a number or string union. And again, TypeScript can infer this correctly. So here again, we have our print function. It takes an x, which is any. And then if we try to print that value, it will give us a type check error. Because I try to multiply x with 42. But thanks to my type definitions I defined earlier, TypeScript actually knows that in this branch, x has to be either a number or a string. It's not any anymore. It's a number or a string. And since strings cannot be multiplied, it will flag a compile error here. So, one last next step. Can we statically type that shape function, that function that type checks complete objects? And the answer is yes, we can. So, as said, shape is a function that takes a map of properties, so it's over here, and properties are expressive type properties. And we already told what the property definitions are. They are a map mapping an attribute name to another type, a runtime type. And so what we know is that if that function produced by shape, the type check function produced by shape, returns true, we know that the value is a valid instance of the type. But we actually can even know what then all the types of the attributes are. And don't worry if you can't read this. It's a foreign language. It's like Russian, I think, or something. But this is how you can make TypeScript aware of that. This uses both mapped types and conditional types. And in the end, what it says is that if a certain property is an instance of a type check function, then please infer for me the generic argument of that original type check function, because that is the type of the object in the end. And so I can imagine that you've lost me here, but I can show it. That explains it way better. So here we have a definition of our soldier again. It's a shape with a name, string type, and an age number type. And now if you go into the print function, we again pass in x as any. So we don't know anything about x. But then we pass x through our generated type check function, the soldier. And suddenly, TypeScript knows all about x. So it knows that the age is a number. And it knows that the name is a string. And also knows that gears is not a valid property of soldiers. So we've just written our own type system in JavaScript and TypeScript, a completely different type system from TypeScript itself. And still, TypeScript is now able to infer all this information from it. And so this is, for example, the reason that when you use Mobix StateTree and you use it in Visual Studio Code, or you use it in Code Sandbox, and you write a model in Mobix StateTree, you get actually auto-completion on all the methods and all the properties you defined yourself, even if you're not using TypeScript, because and anyway, those tools will run TypeScript in the background for you. And so that is how powerful type systems has now become nowadays. So, just to wrap it up. I think we often underestimate the importance of type systems in our applications. So first, it might seem that it like removes agility of your development process, that it's like harder to change stuff. And that might be true if your only ambition is to conquer Brussels. But if your ambition is bigger, that where your project involves many people, and even people that will board off and will board on later, usually the other way around. Anyway, you get it. If your project is big, when it has a long running time, the agility added by types is enormous. It makes it so much easier to refactor in the long term that I cannot stress it enough. And basically, for that reason, I want to end with a quote from Napoleon himself. He learned from his mistakes, and he said, "Amateurs discuss tactics. The professionals, they discuss logistics. Because in the end, it's the logistics that win a war." Thanks.